All right, so in this video, I want to give a brief, just kind of intro to FFI. So FFI stands for Foreign Function Interface. And what that means in every language is simply we can call functions from other languages, right? That's why they are foreign. So generally speaking, how this works is something exports a function. With a known calling convention and so on, from some kind of code. That code, generally speaking, in most languages, will actually just try to kind of convert things into C, let's say, right? And then we are then able to call this as if it was C, generally speaking. Right? So, just this is going to be just a brief explainer on sort of how to define FFI bindings. And so on. And then we're going to take a look at sort of some standard library code just to see, how does this look in practice and so on. And we can take a brief look at a curl example or SQLite or something like this as well, right? And in the next video, we're actually going to incorporate this and also talk about the other side. How do we export functions that can be used from other languages, right? Because it's not just a one-way street. We also want to be able to be called by other languages, right? So the basic kind of syntax that goes into this is going to be foreign import and then some kind of library name. So for example, we might say libcurl here, and then we can say system.curl or colon curl rather. The system here just says this is going to be pulled from whatever standard path you have. We're going to see more of that in the actual standard library. And then we can say foreign libcurl, and then we have definitions here, right? So for let's say also we're gonna have some kind of curl, let's say curl easy, which is a distinct, let's say raw pointer. Not sure about this, but it doesn't matter so much. The idea here is really that this is going to be some kind of handle, let's say. Right, and we could have curl easy init here, which is a proc. And importantly, when we don't specify anything here, what actually is being assumed in a foreign module is this. So this is the C calling convention, and importantly, we also need this here, which means basically there is no implementation. This is effectively, we don't write the implementation here, we only write the types, right? So here we also might say curl global init and so on. And there are some libraries we want to probably have here. We're going to say import that as C, and then we're actually going to say, let's see, flags is a C int here, for example, right? This is not necessarily the actual implementation you would use, by the way. But here we have basically, we've defined two functions we can call in code that come from curl, right? And this is just to sort of illustrate kind of the, like I said, the basic syntax here, right? And so what we can actually say here, we can remove this C here, because it's not needed, but we can also be explicit about it. So we could, for example, say default calling convention C, like this. And this should actually do it. This should now basically assume that there's a C here for every function. Let's just make a main function that sort of calls some of this stuff. Not because we're going to execute it right now, but rather because we want to just call the code, right? So I'm going to say curl global init here and zero. It doesn't matter so much, right? This function exists here. There is a slightly different kind of way we can do some of this stuff, or we can add something here. We can say link prefix. Curl underscore. If a library is kind of well structured like this, we can simply say, hey, this has the curl underscore prefix. So that's what we're going to bind to. And then we can simply say, hey, we can do this. These functions are going to be callable regardless. And in this case, we are in this module, so we have access to global init, right? And so this way, we can actually say, hey, we can remove this prefix entirely. And then if something uses this module, so let me kind of uses FFI, uses FFI, Odin. We're going to write this file, and we are going to say, hey, in uses FFI, package uses FFI. We are going to use this FFI module, right? So we're going to have a main FFI. Hang on, let's see. Import uses, so FFI, like this. FFI dot global init example, right? Now, if this was called curl FFI, for example, right? We would just have global init. We don't have to mention curl twice and so on, right? And this can be a reasonable way to kind of do stuff. And so, yeah, this is kind of the basic, you know, this is how we talk about it, basically. And we can invent our own kind of types here to talk about things a bit more, well, for lack of a better word here, distinctly, right? And that can be very useful, right? So these flags, for example, are actually curl flags. Internally, they might be an int, but here we could regard them as, you know, this is just an, for example, it could be a bit set, which is a way of bundling together different flags together and so on in Odin. We haven't talked about those yet. We might in the future. But yeah, so you can be more specific here about your types if you want. You can make basically an FFI interface that is very, very close to the C version, and then you write a wrapper around that, and that's fine as well, right? So let's just briefly look at two more things. I have an SQLite library that we can take a look at, Odin SQLite 3. And here we can see that we have several different packages and so on here, right? We have the FFI here. And here again, we use this kind of trick, quote unquote, database is a distinct raw pointer, right? A statement is a distinct raw pointer. These are opaque types that we don't know the internals of them. We don't need to know, right? But here you can also see I'm modeling this C interface fairly, you know, it's very C-like in a way, right? So we have this result, and result can be okay, it can be error and so on. We're just using Odin features on top of this, really. And then we have some constants and so on. And here we also use this link prefix idea, but we're defaulting to the C calling convention here because, well, yeah, it's fine. And this is sort of how you can build up, like, okay, I want to use some C library, or I want to use a library from another language also. It doesn't have to be C, generally speaking, though, it tends to be C, right? And you can build up this interface. And importantly, you don't have to write all of these at once, right? Some of these bind functions were only added when I wanted them, for example, right? And so on. And then you have your wrappers on top of this stuff, right? So you have SQLite 3 here, which is really a wrapper on top. We have a statement cache where we have prepared statements and so on and so forth. And now we can be a little bit more like, hey, we can say, you know, we have prepare errors, bind errors, bind map errors, and so on, right? So we can kind of build a more Odin-y, let's call it Odinary interface on top of stuff, right? Because in reality, yes, we do want most of the code to be Odinary, right? But the FFI interface doesn't actually need to follow those things. You can view this in some ways as, you know, when you write unsafe functions in a language that has sort of more safety, let's say, and then you basically wrap them in safe functions, right? And that's fine. So yeah, I just wanted to show this as an example of this as well, and we're going to take a look briefly at the actual core library also in the libc section. And that's only because, well, you might know some of these functions and so on. There are, of course, even more interesting FFI stuff that we can take a look at. But we're going to go into some of those things. We're actually going to interface with Erlang and Elixir in the next episode. So we're going to export functions for Erlang and Elixir to run. And we're also going to import the Erlang C code in order to define those functions. So we're going to be going both ways. But let's take a look here at libc. We can take a look at sort of Erno here first, mostly because it has this foreign import section here. And here you can see how this is done, like foreign import libc, system C, etc. Right? We also have this when conditions here, and these are basically compile time ifs. Well, they are compile time ifs, right? So they describe basically how to actually do these things depending on the operating system. There are a few ways of doing that in Odin. One of them is file prefixes, or file suffixes, I should say. So when you underscore a file with Linux, underscore a file with Windows, etc., as a suffix before Odin, you basically get this compiled on that platform only, and so on. And that can be a very useful way to do this. Some of the standard library is actually kind of, it was written before some of these features. Let's take a look at stdio, so standard IO. And of course we have these whens here. We're gonna try to kind of ignore some of that, and we're gonna take a look more at, let's say, pure functions instead. Here we can, by the way, see that there are constants also, right? So this is interesting also, right? Because we have these standard in, standard out, standard err, and so on. And these are pointers to files and so on. And files, of course, are basically, they should be handles. So this here, you can see this is basically an opaque type. It doesn't contain anything. It's just a handle to a thing. That's what this pointer to file is, right? We don't actually know the internal structures of this because it doesn't matter. We have a handle to a thing that we then pass to different functions. This is a very common pattern. You could make this a distinct raw pointer here, and I don't think anything would be different. It's nice to, you know, the struct is sort of just a different solution to the same problem there. Because structs are distinct, by the way, that's actually why that trick is being used as well, right? So a struct is always distinct, no matter what it contains, right? There's no structural typing in Odin. So here we can see that libc, we can, for example, say fopen, right? What does that take? Well, it takes a file name and a mode. Both of these are C strings, and they return a pointer to a file, right? And here we can see the shape of this interface is definitely, you know, fairly nicely structured here, right? We have this file type that explains to us what is everything taking and so on and so forth, right? And that's nice. We also have these a bit more quote unquote simpler functions here. We have puts and so on and so forth, right? And so a lot of these should seem, the reason we chose this file and so on is these should seem fairly, we should know some of these, right? If we've used C, if you haven't, that's fine as well, of course. I mean, there's no problem with that, right? But this is fairly straightforward, right? We have a proc here. It takes this handle and so on. We can rewind our file by this, by using this. Fseek and so on. Hey, what are we actually rewinding to? And long here is interesting, right? Because this is actually not kind of a standard type necessarily in that we use all the time in Odin, right? If we go to long, we can actually see here in types.odin that it's defined as a C long here. This is only so we get a more, let's say, C-like way of talking about these things, right? But yeah, so that's the, this is how FFI is written, how it's actually in practice written and so on. You can see, of course, it can get, some of it gets complicated when you actually want to say, hey, this supports every platform and so on. But I would just say, hey, you don't absolutely need that in your project right now. right? Write your FFI in pieces, right? One piece at a time. That's really how you can do this, right? In this previous example with the SQLite, none of this was actually just written at once, right? Just look at the docs. Hey, I want to do this thing. What do I need in order to support that? And so on and so forth, right? And you're going to get there eventually, right? And yeah, I think that's it for this. Like I said, in the next episode, we're going to be actually looking at a practical example, running it and so on. We're going to go both ways. We're going to export functions to Erlang, and we're going to import the Erlang interface so we can talk about Erlang data types and so on. So yeah, that's it for this one. If you liked the video, if you liked the information and so on, toss a like. Subscribe to the channel if you want to see more of these things, and have a nice day and ciao.